Because Ali has just forced me to do so. For this session, I will be comparing two pieces of artwork. The first one is Rachel White Reads the House, and the second one is Sun in a Room by Edward Hopper. I keep getting his name wrong. Okay, I did the cultural framework of the house. But I changed it a little bit because I felt that some of the elements in other frameworks are more important than the ones which were just in the cultural framework. So to begin with, a brief introduction to Rachel White Reed and the relevance of her work, The House, is that Rachel White Reed is born in 1963 in London. And she is one of the young British artists, which means that she is a contemporary artist, and she's still active. And then her main type of artwork she produces is including public sculptures and monumental statues. She built a lot of them. Like, the first one she built was The Ghost. And The Ghost was actually replicating a Victorian era room, which is similar to the one she lived in before, I found out. And then in all her works, one significant factor which is similar is that time was the only thing absent from her work, because basically she just casts everything using cement, and which traps every memory. Every single second or every other thing which happened inside the room or the house. She also, like the house and also the ghost, is basically resonant and monuments for individuals who lived in the house, as well as the collective memories that were gained, that were produced in the house. There were contradictions of her house, which is what I found very interesting to put under the social factor, is that there was one party, which is the Tate Gallery, who were so into her works for its significance in capturing time and memory, where they actually decided that she should be presented the Turner Prize in 1993, whereas the other party, which is the Bow Neighborhood Councillors, they voted for the house to be demolished in January 1994 because it delayed the development of East London region. Moving on to the historical and political factor, which I found very, very interesting, is that the area, the East End London, and the Grove Road is basically where World War II has highly affected the region. It's basically both an architectural, the house is basically both an architectural form of an open memorial, which highlights the political conflict arose during the World War II. And basically, the area of the Grove Road is where the flying bomb first fell. So, from my personal opinion, I think she built the house in that area to make it as a monument for the people who served in the war, who died in the war, or even those who were bombed out, or like those survivors who were less capable of living a more comfortable and natural life than those who were affected by the war. And because she has this deep meaning of the house, of her work, Tate Gallery decided that she should be awarded the Turner Prize at 1993, as I have mentioned earlier. But just to add on a little bit about the Turner Prize, she actually wanted to decline the offer because because she is one of the only artists who produces art for its purest reasons. She, because her mother was an artist, she knew that a real artist would. She knew that a real artist wouldn't make money out of what they do, and she did. And she knew that wealth isn't her main purpose, so she went for more conceptual, something more personal to her. And also, when she there was one point of time when she got famous, she started teaching people how to, she started teaching a collective group of students on how to cast, and that's when she's just suddenly decided to stop teaching them because the students, their main motive was to be as rich as her. And I don't think I have to touch on the reward, but I find her very humane, and I think she's like the true artist, which is rarely visible in the present days. Moving on to the visual analysis, basically the house, well, I wasn't able to put the picture because I was really in the space. But you can imagine the picture. Basically, the house is a life-size replica of a Victorian terrace house. It is the location and everything I'll move into later. And then it is, I think she chose a Victorian house. She has a thing for Victorian terrace house because she used to live in one. And like I said earlier, the ghost was similar to the one she lived. And probably because it's the same Victorian terrace house, it was more personal. And she find this, she could have find it more comfortable and stuff. Basically, the process of the house, it sounds complicated. No, it sounds not complicated, but it's actually very complicated because she actually got the perfect shape. Basically, firstly, they just sprayed liquid into the building. The liquid here is the cement. And then after it hardened, they removed the external walls carefully. And it's an inverse representation of a three-story house because you know how people think that the outside of a house matters most because they want to show people that this is the kind of house I live in. But for her, what was inside was more personal, and what and those were the things more meaningful than the outside. And then it was complete. It looks very complete because of the outlines of fireplaces, windows, architraves, and staircases. It's very, very visible, which is exactly why people find it so astonishing, and they were taken aback the moment they saw it. And then there were indentations of domestic details that were expressed in a way where Rachel Whiteread is an artist who finds that, who likes to take something which was disregarded, something not meaningful, something very ordinary to make them something very, very extraordinary. Like the house, it was in the Grovewood. Oh, moving to the location, the house is located in Grove Road. It's actually very relevant to what I was seeing at the East End London. And most of the roads there were like destroyed during the World War II because of the flying bomb, including some of the houses in Grove Road, like I mentioned earlier. In the 1950s, like after war, it was covered with temporary houses. And then in 1993, which is like 43 years later, they removed all the terrace, like including the houses which are similar to the house. Yeah. And these people who the residents of these terrace houses were actually forced to move out by the Liberal Democrat Council because they wanted to develop the area. And then, basically the house is the interior of one of the last remaining terrace houses. It's basically for it was nothing special. It was torn down. It was it just was a sad scene because the house itself just reflects on the entire war period. But for the moment it was built as the house. It was very special. Like 10,000 or thousands of visitors came in to look at the house. And then, which is exactly what she wants to show, I think. And then I think she is very modest. She appreciates everything, including the air we breathe in, like this space here. I think probably like her house, it was filled with a lot of things, a lot of very memoric things. I think she wanted people to think of the normal space like that. And then the house is located in the middle of churches, high towers and parks, which makes it look small and vulnerable. But it was still standing up because it was special. It was casted in cement. And then she was actually thanked by two former residents because they said that she actually made their memories real, collective, like no one really cared about them because East End, London, especially the Grove Road, these are the people who were like really affected by war and they were very neglected by the society and all. But Rachel White Reed took the initiative to appreciate, like just acknowledge that their presence and like. Next. The sun in the room. I did a formal framework, but similar like the previous one, I altered the elements in it a bit because I felt that there were more to talk about in some parts than the actual parts of the formal framework. Like the house, I was first start off with some social facts about the sun in the room. It's actually created by Edward Hopper. He was born in New York in 1882. He was one of the most influential American painters like till present date. He was a painter. He was born in a middle class family, and by middle class in back then, they actually encouraged a lot of art, especially visual arts. Than music and performing arts like now. And then he is a painter of, he's similar like Rachel White Reed. He takes something very ordinary and makes it very standing out and very precious and personal for himself. He made three trips to Paris between 1906 and 1910, which altered his entire career in art. It influenced his artworks very heavily, whereby because before this he was actually working as illustrators and just designers, and he was just doing things people asked him to do, but he just suddenly thought that he had his own intentions. He wanted to pursue his imagination, which is why he just got out of work and he made three trips to Paris. Paris at that time is the artistic center of the Western world. It's like American music now. It's very strong, it's very powerful. They stand up most in the art history at that time. And when he was in Paris, he was impressed by the city, the architecture, the lights, and the art tradition. Because American at the time, it was undergoing its expansion period, and then they were very isolated from the whole world, and they were very deformed, I would say. And he just went to Paris, and it was like a Disneyland for him. And then he was exposed. He actually went to Paris to learn about old masters. It's a movement which lasted for 100 or 200 years, I forgot, before, like way before other movements started. But at that moment when he went, it was the abstract expressionist art movement which was leading. But, and then at the same time, cubism was introduced, like just new, freshly introduced. So he was exposed to all three art movements firsthand. And he encountered with impressionism as well, in which he found the light, the thematic treatment of architecture and nature very, very, he found the purest thing the most precious, which is why in all of his works he highlights the structure of architecture, the use of lightings. It's very, very visible. If you just type Edward Hopper on Google, you can see everything. Moving on to style first. It's basically an oil canvas painting. I think he personally chose all the canvas painting because the strokes, every strokes of oil paint actually creates a very shimmering effect, which actually makes the wall shimmer and makes it look like it's real sunlight. And then oil paint actually enabled him to express the numerous tones of yellow. If you see the picture, if you see the picture, in the room is basically everything is yellow, it's just different tones from something warm to something very cool and then something very dull. Like the opacity of the color is very, very different. Like even on the same part of the wall, it's different. So I think he selected oil painting because it can he can express the tone naturally and smoothly. And then the trees outside the window looks like as though they are lit, as though there is air. But if you see it from a different perspective, it doesn't look like air. It's just like that. It's just deformed. And I'm still looking into it. And then shadows are painted in an overlapped manner. They are not like shadows like the walls. They have different tones as well, in which he emphasized on the opacity of shadow to make the entire painting look very three-dimensional and real. Visual analysis. The sun in the room looks like a photograph, but it is not a photograph. It has a little bit of sense of surrealism in it because if you see right in the picture, this one you have to see. You see right, there is no cast of shadow of this thing, like the window pane. There's no shadow casting on there. And that's I'll explain that in symbols and metaphor. And then the color theme is very simple. It's tones of yellow, but it looks a bit more brownish. So it's brownish yellow. It created a bright yet a very solemn atmosphere. And then the slanting light, the direction of sunlight formed into the room is quite slanted, which expresses whether it's dawn or dusk. It's not noon, definitely. But in my personal opinion, I think it's dusk, because in the morning it's not very yellow as the evening. And then the indoors, it's very dreamlike. There is an incandescent glow which isolates the room from the very urban society outside. And then the empty room actually created a haunted atmosphere, which I'll explain further here. And then there is simplified composition, which I think like the sun in the room is the most simplified work of his. And I think it's because he wanted to just emphasize on the abstract and focusing only on light and shadow, because he was very famous for it. And the shimmering light suggests that the room is either not occupied, not used, or just recently vacated. Because dust, shimmering light can mean that there's dust present in the room. Because if you see, if it's just light, it doesn't make it glow, but if there's a bit of dust, you can see like things a bit. Symbols and metaphor. It was, the painting was basically done 4 years before his death, and this, and I think it's, it, the painting itself is a metaphor, because he was actually really, really sick. He went for a lot of surgeries. I think I put it in another, I think I put it in another, the other slide. Yeah. And I think the room is the memory of his, and he wanted to make it, he wants to make it safe. Wants to trap all the memories, whereby all the space in the room is, because the space in the room is emphasized. And then there's a window. The trees outside looks windward, but you can't really hear the wind. Meaning, it looks like it's windward, but it's actually not. I think he's trying to explain how people, they might look distorted, or like the American society back then, they looked very dull and everything, but they were still enduring the pain. They were still trying to get up, because it was during the expansion period. Revolution was going to start. They still had hope. They still had motivation to stand up. I think that's what he did then. And then the black walls and wheat and honey colored sunlight. I actually researched this, and some critics said that these are the two things he loved most and most comfortable with. I think because when they said, like when as we are heading towards our death, we will think of the things we like most, and we will recall whatever happened and everything. And I think that was the phase he was going through. And then originally, he said that originally at the window pane there was supposed to be a woman, but at the end he changed his mind, because, and then there were some critics that said that he believes that light and the room, the memory, can live without love, but he personally can't. And I think this is a very heartbreaking thing, because he met his wife, who was his fellow student in university, and they got like married 1 year later, and then they were really, really, really in love. They were still affectionate until he died. So he was very lonely, but he was not because of his wife. He was lonely because he's gonna die alone, but he was not lonely because of his wife. And then the light, I think. It's basically, the sunlight is like basically a push force, a life force for him. Because, you know when you watch a lot of movies and then there's a scene of someone dying in the hospital, they always sit outside, they always sit facing through the windows, right? I think it's the same metaphoric thing there. Because, like, I die, but the world is still going. So, it's like, it's not a matter of me being, me being sad of dying, I just have to accept the fact that I'm dying, because the world is really, the world's not gonna end as I die. And then basically the whole painting itself, I think, like after I analyzed it, I felt that it was like a very heartbreaking artwork, because it's one of his last artwork, and he was just recalling everything he did in life. I thought it was sad. And then the color yellow, it's normally used as something happy and all, but he made it look sad. So he was making every happy memory he had sad, because he was going to leave them as he dies. Okay, personal reflection of both words. The house. I personally think that the house was expected that it was going to be broken down because the entire Grove Road did that, and like when it got demolished, like she built it in autumn 1993, but it got demolished in January 1994. It's actually really quick, but she didn't really stand up to protect the house, you know, like other people protected the house, not her. So I think she was actually like, when she was making it, I think she was already letting go of the house. It's just to capture it for a while, and everything disappears like the Grove Road, but the Grove Road is still. And then, from an architectural view, I think she was trying to highlight how development led to the change of lifestyle. Like, the house was very Victorian-ish, but the things that surrounded the house, it was developing, it was becoming more urban, and it was just, I think she was just sad to see that people were like letting go of their, what they call the original identity, you know, they were holding on to their paradigm. The plain colors and the color stains on the house, the cast itself, is, I think she was just trying to capture the purest and the most broken down memories that were built. Do you say building memories? Yeah, that were built inside the house. She was just trying to express the beauty of the emptiness. It was empty, but it's not empty. You see, she was trying to highlight it. And then I actually came up with some ideas for paper casting because the criteria. I thought when I was looking at the Rachel Whitebeard's house, I thought of using like unused drawers, like toy boxes or like jewelry boxes, because that was basically my everything in my childhood. It's like it was my life force when I was 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And now that I think about it, I only liked it because the outside thing looked pretty. But what mattered more was the things I kept inside. So I thought I can try looking for one at home, but I just hope that I can. And then, because I chose to do like this kind of boxes because for some other people in my life, just like it's just a box, but I also thought that it was just a box, but that box was basically my entire childhood. So now that I was reflecting, I thought it would just like imitate Rachel Whitebeard's intention in casting the house. And then I'm still in a dilemma in choosing whether to use classroom and do paper casting in the sense that I fill the box with tissue paper. But I think I'm gonna experiment both of them. And then suddenly through basically the room explains the state of his health at that time. It was 4 years before that, like I said earlier, he went through like prostate surgeries and like suffered other medical problems, and he could have felt lonely. I'm sure like everyone who's sick, they feel lonely. And then it was dusk. I think it was dusk, I don't think it was dawn because it was yellow. It suggests the end of the day, like, and I think he was looking forward as if it's the end of his life. And then he was influenced from just looking at the painting, he was influenced by abstract expressionism. It's just that he didn't really focus on like, he just used a lot of strokes. Like, I don't think he was very conscious because he was sick. I think that's why, that's like my personal view, that he was influenced by abstract expressionism and cubism, because the rooms are like really, really structured, and it was three-dimensional. And I think if you just take his works as a blueprint, I think they could literally like make a room. Or a room. And then he was exposed to surrealism. Like, there was no shadow of the window pane that makes sense, just not the central window pane. I think he was like indicating his struggle, like that pain, like the window pane is his struggle for the decade. Because after he got out of work, his works weren't recognized for like about 10 years or so. So he was really suffering. He was basically undergoing poverty, but because his family itself is a middle class, so I think he had funding from families. But it's like his struggle, but there's no cast of shadow, means people doesn't know that he was struggling. That's my interpretation. And then some ideas for studio practice which I came up with as I was looking through his work is that it's relevant to architecture. So I think I should like really look into a lot of his works because I want to be an architect. I think I have to like start exploring how shadows cast and how tones of walls is different because of the shadow, because of light. And then I think that I have to explore like different tones of certain color, especially using oil paint because I never used oil paint before. I need to like know how it can change because I tried with acrylic, it wasn't that efficient. When I was painting for Bob Marley. And then I tried with watercolor, but that was quite, it was effective, but it's just a matter of like controlling water. But I think oil paint would be different, like the painting. And then I have to like experiment on oil painting because I didn't even use one before. And then I also think that I have to observe the relationship between sunlight and the direction of shadow. Because like during even still life drawings, I find it really hard to cast shadows. Because I just find them very awkward. It's like it doesn't fit to the picture I draw. So yeah. And then Venn diagram. I will start with the house and then the sun and then the two and then the intersection. The house is basically a contemporary artwork. She is one of the YBA. It's a cement cast. It's something like a sculpture, but it's not a sculpture because it's just so huge. And then it was basically to capture memories of other people whilst reflecting back in her life. Like, as I said, she used to live in a Victorian terrace house, and she couldn't find her house is the best place on earth, and she could have like thought that other people felt it too, but it's just that because it was located in Grove Road, nobody really cared. They just like looked down on them and they just disregard them, and like the way how they were like shoot out of the community, I think she was trying to express that these people have feelings too, they have their own memories in the house. And then it raised a lot of controversial issues in the society because it was delayed development, and it was basically reflecting on World War II, which isn't a very good thing at that time because it wasn't quite very after the war, I think. And then I personally think she had a more masculine approach because if you think of women, like if people think of women, they would just think that they would just sit in their place, do their thing they have to do. But she like cement cast the entire building, which I think was more macho-ish and more heroic. And then suddenly this is the difference between the two. It's a realism artwork, which is basically influenced by a lot of other art movements. And it's an oil on canvas painting piece. And unlike her trying to capture memories of other people as well as hers. He was just reflecting on his own life because he was on his, not on his deathbed, but he was on the way to his death, like very close. And then it was suggesting that she was expecting death, but she was just sad about it. And then, unlike this, which caused a lot of issues, the painting was just admired because he had this talent of, I think it's a talent because not many people can do it, in like adjusting the tone and the opacity of light and shadow, like in all his other works. And then, like the house is more masculine, I think the sun in the bedroom is more feminine because he emphasized on every stroke. He was very precise and everything. So I would personally say that it's a feminine approach, but I don't know about your opinion. And then the intersection. Both artworks have the theme of space, emptiness, memories, like capturing memories, and then capturing space, capturing time, holding, like expressing a lot of different mixed feelings in the room, the house they made, built. Then they both of them have this mindset of trying to take something like which was always disregarded, which was never ever cared of, which was never looked into before, into something very extraordinary, something very astonishing, something very motivating. And then both had relevance to architecture, which is why I love both of them, because they give me so much ideas for my future career. Ta-da! Yay.